Speculative zoology had my interest from a very young age and onwards. What would life be like on other planets, especially planets very different from Earth? I still have fond memories of working out an entire biosphere on the gas giant of Jupiter in this thin little notebook, probably during school hours. At least 3 decades later, I dug it up again, retraced all my drawings, and now it's ready to be presented to the world for the first time. So let's get to it! By the mid-80s, I had already spent many afternoons and evenings designing fantasy creatures using nothing but pen and paper and my imaginative young mind. My inspiration for this crazy idea came from 2 main sources. First of all, of course, Sagan and Salpeter's vision for life forms on Jupiter. I did have Sagan's book, Cosmos, based on his famous TV series. I was fascinated by reading the parts of the book where the hypothetical ideas for Jovian life were described and illustrated. Secondly, I saw an episode on TV of a cartoon series called Starcom, which was a science fiction set in our solar system of the near future. The episode played out on Jupiter and featured life forms like air whales and their predators, which were clearly taken from Sagan's depictions. Enthusiastically, I started jotting down my own ideas in this notebook. I wanted to combine what I just saw in TV and what I could read up on from the book. I'm still rather proud of what I managed to envisage and how many details I worked out, despite being a bit messy about it in my little notebook. On the first page, I wrote down some of my own speculations on the biochemistry of Jupiter, clearly trying to apply what I just learned in school. I thought one could simply combine methane with water somehow into sugar and hydrogen. The hydrogen would then probably add the additional benefit of making the organism lighter. I had no access to scientific literature or even any idea of how to get that, let alone knowing about Carl Sagan even having co-authored an entire article about this very subject. I'm still not very strong in chemistry, but this looks to me like an okay guess from me back then at what Sagan and Salpeter themselves proposed. Most experts assume that the orange hues in Jupiter's atmosphere are due to polymeric sulfur produced by hydrolysis of sulfides. Nevertheless, Sagan and Salpeter argue for this perhaps being biotic in nature. They envisaged Jovian chromophores being able to marshal light for combining methane, water, and ammonia into more complex molecules. For this to work, mainly blue light would be absorbed, accounting for the orange-red hue of the chromophores. Their basic vision for an ecosystem consisted of sinkers, floaters, and hunters. Sinkers would rapidly reproduce, with some of their offspring being lucky enough to be carried upwards again. Floaters would store hydrogen gas to avoid sinking while pumping out the heavier helium, and hunters would be predatory and living off other organisms. With this established, I then drew a simple evolutionary tree of the different stages of life on Jupiter. The initial stage was envisaged to be a so-called pseudobacterium, or in other words, a prokaryote-level organism with a membrane surrounding its biochemistry, including DNA. In my previous video on Jovian life, I speculated that these basic organisms could simply evolve from microscopic floating water droplets, saturated with complex chemistry. One could imagine any self-replicators contained would rapidly evolve ways to keep the water from evaporating by forming a membrane around the droplet. So, whereas I felt uncertain about the concept of floating bacteria at the time, it seems more plausible to me now than ever before. The next stage was seen as something analogous to a eukaryote, so with a more complex composite cell containing additional structures, including a nucleus containing the genome. These were still sinkers, but unicellular, so unicellular sinkers. From there are branches into 2 directions. The first branch is formed by the unicellular floaters that appear to carry some sort of vacuole containing the lighter hydrogen. The other branch is made out of the multicellular sinkers and gliders. Being multicellular will lead to a larger and thus heavier body, so to prevent sinking too fast, these beings evolved a larger surface area to break their descent. Some forms became bilateral in order to glide through the atmosphere and hunt actively. Now these move off into a branch of their own, but also gave rise to multicellular floaters. The multicellular floaters then evolved into 3 main forms: ordinary floaters, self-propelled floaters, and photosynthetic floaters. Out of these self-propelled floaters, active hunters evolved. The pages following this, I fleshed out each of these different groups with several examples. First of all, the multicellular sinkers and gliders. On this page, I gathered a wide variety of forms that I envisaged could evolve. The simplest forms I called primitive mesins, short for multicellular sinker. They would just be a double sheet of cells held together by a tegument, with an opening in the front with hair-like ciliate structures for catching food from the air. I imagined it looking a bit like floating duckweed. A further evolved stage would be a disc-shaped lifeform, flattened to break its fall as much as possible, while gathering food particles from the air using cilia around a central mouth. From the outside, it would have looked a bit like a frisbee or a gliding pancake. An even more derived stage would be active hunters with bilateral symmetry, I called gliders. The glider has a head with a primitive brain and sensory organs like antennae and eyes. It can control its direction using rudders at the rear sides. It seems a bit inspired by a paper plane with a heavy front end followed by a wing-like body. The next creature is also carnivorous, but in a very different way. I speculated it could be exploring drag by allowing air to flow through its bell-shaped body while bouncing off internal septae. Looking very similar to a jellyfish, it catches prey with the dangling tentacles around its mouth. Two other life forms aren't actually sinking or gliding themselves, but attached to other beings. The technical term for animals living on the outside of other life forms is epifauna. One is a filter feeder with a suction cup-like base and long cilia for catching food. The other is a button-like parasite with a needle-like hardened mouth and an armored top. And here you have the full overview of the diversity of multicellular sinkers and gliders. Next up are the multicellular floaters. From the simple idea of a floating, balloon-like creature, I came up with several different designs. The first one is a carnivorous floater that, like the previous jellyfish-like sinker, catches prey passively using a ring of tentacles hanging down. There is a pair of massive jaws with a beak or teeth leading to a gut. All is suspended below a large gas bladder surrounded by pumping cavities for breathing. On the outside, it has a bell or balloon-shaped-like appearance. Then there's a design for a relatively simple self-propelled floater. It's got compartmentalized gas bladders and a ring of lung pumps with exceptionally muscular walls. This way, it can drive itself through the atmosphere to escape from predators, for example. It has a second set of pumps that it uses to suck air through a filter feeding apparatus that passes food to a gut surrounding it. Besides these heterotrophic forms living off other beings, there are also photosynthetic floaters. They have similar gas bladder compartments and the same kinds of lungs for respiration. The mouth area has been reduced and turned into reproductive organs, and the gut is now instead used for storage of food reserves. To increase surface area for catching sunlight, the side flanges are widened into a disc shape. Because of the pigments used for photosynthesis, these floaters have a distinct orange color. Finally, there's a design for an advanced filter feeding floater, where there's a single centralized pump carried by large gas bladders. Air is drawn in along the external mantle, where it is filtered for food particles. It then passes through the central pump further to the lungs in the middle. It's possible that this floater can also be self-propelled, given enough force. Like the other forms, it has a bell-shaped body. So here's the full overview of carnivorous floaters, filter-feeding floaters, photosynthetic floaters, and more advanced forms. On the next page, I created a design for what I was really excited about, a hunter. Hunters were conceptualized by Sagan and Salpeter and illustrated in the artwork created for Cosmos, though not in much detail or with a lot of clarity. Based on my impressions from the Starcom episode, I envisaged it as a kind of air shark. It has a streamlined form with a ventral mouth oriented downwards, leading to a gut that fills most of the body. It propels itself with a muscular pump in the rear that is surrounded by hydrogen bladders. It has a relatively large brain in the front and a set of eyes in close association with it. It has three eyes on top of its head pointing upwards and one below its snout, keeping an eye on what it would be catching and eating. The mouth is constructed as an oral cone of spiky teeth that can open up and close somewhat like a camera diaphragm. When the mouth is open, the teeth radiate outwards, and when closing, they converge inwards, with the tips eventually meeting in the middle. On each side of the body, there are wing-like structures used for steering through the air. The main propulsion is still done by the rear pump, taking air in through a ring of apertures. Thinking this design through a bit more, it strikes me that this hunter probably needs to be flying constantly in order to keep its head level. This is because the hydrogen bladders are situated in the back. Although one could imagine them hanging with their heads down during rest, floating in the atmosphere, oddly similar perhaps to how bats hang from ceilings. From this basic body plan, I created some more advanced or derived varieties on a page dedicated to evolved hunters. The first example is still a generalized hunter, but with some improvements. First of all, the hydrogen bladder is situated more centrally, so the body will stay more level, even when not flying actively. There's a single dorsal bladder and one internal bladder surrounding the front part of the torso. It has a more compact body with larger brains, protected by a brain case of tougher materials. Otherwise, it's very similar to the basic body plan with four eyes and an oral cone. All this extra complexity gives an interesting look as seen from the outside. The oral cone is a bit widened with shorter teeth, but functions using the same principles. Clearly, this body organization allows for staying vertical even when not flying actively. The second variety has been specialized into being parasitic on larger prey creatures. Apart from being even more compact, it also has a sort of a foot to attach it to surfaces. It can still fly, being self-propelled by its rear pumping organ, so it can move from host to host. The oral cone has been shaped into a piercing organ that can be closed into a spike and opened to suck out vital materials. So all in all, this creature is not unlike a mosquito, for example. The following page I delve into the concept of gigantic floaters. Sagan and Salpeter already speculated on floaters kilometers across and the size of cities. In the gravity-suspended ecosystem of a gas giant, this is certainly within the realm of possibilities, and I too explored this idea with two basic designs of giant floaters. The first giant floater I conceived of as a simple design with a central pump for moving air over the lungs placed around it, and enormous hydrogen bladders. It was thought of as being photosynthetic with a large, flattened top surface. The second form I drew has the top extended into a saucer shape to increase surface area. Otherwise, it has the same basic design with a central pump, lungs, and large bladders. The extended top surface gave me the idea of it being inhabited symbiotically by smaller epiflora and epifauna that no longer needed to be airborne themselves. This would, however, decrease solar irradiation for its own photosynthesis, but that would then be compensated by ingesting detritus from the ecosystem it sustains this way. It therefore has a gut that underlies almost the entire width of the platform. I dubbed these giant floaters Rectarius for some reason, and delved into speculations on what creatures may make out its epifloral and epifaunal ecosystem. I imagined plant-like creatures called stemmos, illustrated by several growth forms with either lobe-like leaves or nested discs growing vertically. Detritus would be able to enter the gut of the host through grooves spread over the surface, so you would have to be careful where you tread. The neat thing with these giant floaters is that these provide terra firma, allowing for analogues of land-based life forms on a gas planet with no solid surface otherwise. I came up with several intriguing possible life forms on the pages following this introduction. First of all, there's the so-called slimpo or crawler that is deceivingly similar to a snail, but actually has quite a different build. It's described as a descendant of a parasitic hunter that has gone over to living off stemmos that grow on the surface of the giant floaters, so becoming a herbivore. On its back, a large pumping lung sticks out, used more for respiration than for propulsion now. It may incidentally look like the house of a snail, but it's an entirely different structure. In front of this, two external plates cover the area where the central nervous system is bundled. The brain is connected to the three eyes that are extended upwards on a single stalk. Beneath the eyes, there's the mouth, adorned with front teeth specialized for biting of chunks and back teeth meant for mastication. The gut continues backwards, ending in the middle of the body, beyond which there is a muscular foot. Using backwards pointing spines on the underside, it actually moves more like an inchworm than a snail. There's also an example of the Slenpo's main food source here, a photosynthetic stemo called a photemo. In cross-section, you can see a central gas bladder embedded inside more sturdy materials as a sort of endoskeleton. The base is concave and muscular, indicating a suction cup and thus the ability to relocate. Next up is a highly mobile ground predator evolved from hunters that were originally airborne. Called the Curo or silver hare, its complex anatomy can be clearly seen in cross-section. Like its ancestors, it has an oral cone to act as jaws with grasping teeth, but also a battery of grinding teeth further down the throat. There's also the usual aerated lung at the back end. The Curo shows clear signs of cephalization, with the eyes and central nervous system in close association with the mouth at the front of the body sticking out upwards. The brain is encased in a skull-like structure that also provides articulation points for the teeth. The gut consists of a series of stomachs and an intestinal tract exiting at the back. Apart from several other skeletal elements, a striking feature of this animal is the presence of an internal pump or open heart, clearly meant for moving vital substances towards the head. The backside of the Curo is lined with hairs, implying it's endothermic, generating its own body heat. Although its ancestors may have started out with an inchworm-like way of moving around, like the Slenpo, it clearly has a more dynamic mode of locomotion with elongated clawed feet. The hairs are implied to be transparent like glass fiber, to which it owes its alternative name of silver hair, and its silvery hue is augmented by its light purplish-blue color. In overview, this is already quite a fascinating ground-based flora and fauna for a gas planet. You have plant-like primary producers, herbivorous prey animals, and carnivorous predators. On the final pages, I found a couple of bonus creatures alluding to even further evolution. They're not completely worked out, but fascinating nevertheless. The first form appears to be a larger and more complex descendant of the Slenpo. It's got plates and shells around most of its body, adorned by protective spines. The mouth and eyes are at the end of a bodily extension or trunk for reaching higher places. It may look like a head, but the actual brain is encased deeper inside the body. The trunk can be retracted inside the shell, so the entire body can be protected from danger. It's got the usual posterior lung and through gut, but with more convoluted surfaces. The final bonus creature is rather mysterious, as there's no cross-section showing its innards. However, it's clearly a highly advanced life form and probably sentient, if not even sapient. It looks like it could be a relative of the silver hare of the previous page, but much more evolved. For one thing, it has well-defined paired limbs in a dinosaurian-like configuration. It would therefore have some kind of endoskeleton, but at least on the head, an external shell is visible, looking like a helmet and probably protecting a relatively large brain. It also looks like it could be airborne with a large air pump for self-propulsion, plus a dorsal fin and lateral fins for stability and maneuvering. The oral cone seems to have developed into fused jaw-like teeth with sharp spikes, so this is presumably meant to be a carnivorous creature. Well, I hope you enjoyed this little blast from my past. Looking back at these early imaginations of mine, I'm rather impressed by my teenage self. And reviewing these wondrous creatures, I feel inspired to have some further thoughts. I will do these in a future video, so please do subscribe and make sure you hit the bell icon. For now, thanks for watching, cheers and bye-bye!